So good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Just to clarify, today we have gathered here for a yoga workshop. Not necessarily an asana workshop. So I, when I teach, I make it a point to point out the difference. Because this time, asana has become the whole and soul of yoga. Asana is the physical practice. Even when I teach the teachers, to become yoga teachers, I ask them, you need to know if you are an asana teacher or a yoga teacher. What's the difference? Asana is purely physical. Though some component of it is with the mind, but asana is purely, the end game of asana is to work with the body. But the goal of yoga itself is not the body. The goal of yoga as a whole is to go beyond the body. Or to bring your body in such a harmonious state that the body is not bothersome anymore. So in that context, our today's workshop is a small trailer of sorts of bringing your body back in harmony. That's why we've called it rehab. It's a popular word nowadays, so is rehab means rehabilitation. And why we call it rehab is because see, our body in its natural state is beautifully capable of bearing a lot of things. Our body is the most intelligently created, if I can say, machine. I mean, the science still doesn't understand how it functions. Actually, just last week I was reading that they have discovered a new organ just under the skin. We still discovered. Actually, last year I read that they have discovered one more organ somewhere in between the lining of the intestine. What I'm trying to say is that our body is a very, very beautiful and intelligent system. Shouldn't call it a machine, system. See, so what I was talking about is our body is a very beautifully self-balanced system. Naturally, our body has different systems. Muscular system, the skeletal system, the cardiovascular system. More than 11 systems in our body, and all those systems function optimally. For example, our body, the shape of our spine is so beautifully organized that they say that the spine has its own integrity. The way it is organized, the way it can stand by itself. So body inherently is intelligent and a perfected system. But the carrier of the body, that is us, messes with it. It's like you buy a very beautiful sports car and you give it to somebody who just learned to, say, ride a bicycle. You buy a beautiful Ferrari, everything. Each and every nut and bolt that has gone into that Ferrari is perfected, tested. When the Ferrari left the factory, it was, that's it. No error. But then the driver, for the first time he was getting that in a car, in any car, and then he doesn't know how reactive his foot is, he just steps on the gas and boom. We are the carriers of our. And looking at the lifestyle that we live, all little things like the mind, like what you eat, how much you sleep, everything has a direct effect on the body. It's not just about if you had an accident. Especially today we are discussing a very delicate area, neck and shoulders. It's a very delicate part of the body. But I feel it is also much abused part of the body. So body in itself is a very balanced system. It is made for use, but because of our improper lifestyle, and I'm blaming the lifestyle, and I'll tell you what all is a component of that lifestyle. What happens? Misuse. Disuse, overuse, and therefore abuse. All this happens. Misuse means, a very simple example of misuse is something called as a forward head syndrome. Have you heard of that? Nowadays, since this last 10 years, there's a new illness called forward head syndrome, and I have a diagram for that, I have a picture for that. It's a new age disease. Our head is supposed to sit on our shoulder, on the neck, and the line of the ear needs to be perfectly balanced over the shoulder. But what's happening is, because of all the handheld devices and the projection devices, our head is moving forward, 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 forward. So the natural position, alignment of the head sitting on the shoulder is becoming like this now. This is misuse. What is disuse? Disuse means not many people are moving the shoulders the way we used to even 50 years ago. I mean, tomorrow we are doing lower back and knees and stuff. I'm going to talk about this a little even more over there. For example, you know, our arm doesn't extend as much. The function of the arm has been taken over by the thumb. Isn't it? I mean, during our school days, we used to reach out to lift the, or answer the phone, no? Even a basic task like to answer a call, we had to walk to the phone, then actually extend our arm and then fold our arm, so at least that exercise. Today, the function of the whole shoulder joint has been taken over by the thumb. That is disuse. Overuse. All those little, and I have some strong images to show you, because many times shocking techniques work. Whenever in our body, if you're overusing one part, remember there's another part that you are underusing or disusing. That's why it is very, 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 very important to come back to the body. In this sense, this is the beauty of yoga. We cannot take our body for granted anymore. Why have you come to this session? Is it because do you have a shoulder and neck issue? Or do you don't want to have it? I mean, you know, you can come for both reasons. How many of you have an active shoulder and neck issue? So what I would like to do is, since it's a short session, I would like to really, if you don't mind, do some general stuff and then take case studies. Huh? What do you think?
Yeah.
It'd be nice to have real life examples and see if things happen. Another thing I want to tell you is, our body is not just a carrier, not just a vehicle. It is intelligence. Intelligence means, what do we usually think? Our body is just something we live in and it helps us move. This is what we are told our body is. But our body is a very important communication mechanism. Means, please try to understand this. When I sit like this, I will tell you what, from outside you don't see any difference. You don't know what's communicating within, okay? I am supposed to be like this, carry myself like this, but because of whatever reason, say weak muscles, mental tension, depression, feeling sad, what happens? Natural tendency of body is to involute. Now when I go like this, what is happening is, now understand the physiology behind it, okay? Because I know many of us have children and most of the teenagers are growing up like this nowadays. Most of them. And they already have forward head syndrome. So I'll tell you what happens with the physiology, okay? Once you're like this, your chest or ribs depress. Doesn't get enough space to expand. Rib cage is the outer wall of the lungs. If the rib cage is tight, lungs do not get enough capacity to expand. That means not much air is going in. Not much air is going in means less oxygen going to the brain. I'm telling you the whole chain. Less oxygen going to the brain means brain fatigue. Brain fatigue means irritability. Irritability means bad social interaction. That's one direction. Or impatience or self-blame or whatever. Second, less oxygen to the brain becomes, literally the data, less oxygen going to the brain interprets that as stressful situation. When the brain interprets something as stressful situation, what will the brain produce? There are all organs inside the brain that stimulate the creation of hormones and neurotransmitters, the inner chemicals of the body. When the brain interprets or concludes, there's actually nothing wrong with your life is fantastic, but you just happen to carry yourself like this. So outside, your life is amazing, you are happy, your kids are happy, enough money, job security, life is good, but posture is bad. Now, the brain doesn't know life is good. Brain is only going to interpret the data that is getting through the body. And where the brain is going to take the data from? All the nerves that are flowing through the body to the head. All the nerves report back to the brain. Okay? So the nerves from the chest muscle are going to tell the brain a lot of constriction. The diaphragm that helps you breathe because you sit like this is going to get choked. So diaphragm is not going to move. When the diaphragm doesn't move, what is the brain going to interpret? She is in trouble. Again, when you hold your body like this, all the blood flow, especially to the carotid artery that is here, I have a picture of that. The blood supply, the main blood supply that goes to the brain, is also restricted. So ultimately from this region, what is the data that's going to the head, to the brain? The brain is getting the data that things are not normal. When the brain concludes that things are not normal, what chemicals it is going to produce? Fight or flight. But actually, superficially, there's nothing wrong with your life. You see that? So outer life and inner life are opposing. That's why many times people fall sick when actually there's nothing wrong with their lives as such. Does that scare you enough? But this is true. We have to understand that it's not just the mind. The brain is getting data from each and every little square millimeter of your body. from here, from the way you breathe. If you're inhaling more, if you're exhaling less, that itself is something called a sympathetic response, means anxious, anxiety. All this has a huge implication on your inner physiology. That's why today our main focus is posture correction. You know, one of my favorite pastimes at the airport is, you know, I go early, I check in everything and all, and I sit at the gate, get my cup of tea, and I just watch people. Because I'm a student of biomechanics. So I just watch people, how they walk, how they carry themselves, and it's appalling. Especially when you're traveling, you know, and especially if you're like me who has a habit of carrying the bag only on one shoulder. Okay, ready? Ready for some rehab?